Kappa League TV.
I'm Niles Holt from Alpharetta Smyrna Alumni Chapter Kappa League, and you're watching Kappa League TV. Atlanta's native son and Kappa brother, Andre Dickens, was sworn in as the city's 61st mayor in January. I sat down to learn more about his passion of becoming mayor and improvements he plans for the city. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Dickens.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
First off, how does it feel to be elected as mayor in the city that you grew up in and in the city that you attended college in?
It's a wonderful thing. This is a dream come true. I had this dream when I was 16 years old that I wanted to be mayor of Atlanta. Being born and raised here, I knew that Atlanta was a very special place on earth. And I set my sights towards becoming mayor one day. I told my mom about it. I told friends about it. I even told leadership in the city about it. And, I believe that dreams are made to come true. I didn't think I had this vision for no reason. I had it for a real reason, and that was for it to come true. And I thank God that it did. And, Elder Watson Diggs, a founder of our fraternity, he was better known as the Dreamer. And my line when I pledged Kappa was six keepers of a dream. So I fundamentally believe that I had a dream. I saw it through. All my friends and supporters helped me get there. And, God blessed me with this, and I'm excited.
What are some key items that you want to accomplish as mayor?
Well, right now we have a tale of two cities, a lot of prosperity, that people have a lot of great opportunities. They have a lot of money. They have they have freedom, but then there's still parts of the city that don't have those things. They don't have a lot of money or access. There's actually a lot of poverty. And so I want to overcome this multi-generational poverty where people that were born in poverty right now only have a 4% chance of making it to the upper middle class in Atlanta. And so for me, my goal is to make sure that people have an opportunity to a good job, a great education, good skills and training, great health, health outcomes, and affordable housing. So I'm really about equity, access, and inclusion to make sure all people thrive in Atlanta.
How has your Atlanta roots prepared you for this position as mayor?
Well, I'm prepared because, I know the legacy of great Atlanta leaders like Maynard Jackson. I was born just 6 months after Maynard Jackson took office as the first Black mayor for Atlanta. And being born and raised in Atlanta and going to an Atlanta public school system and graduating from Benjamin Mays High School, I know the legacy of the city. And I understand where we can be and what we have is great historical leadership, how we work together and come together. I understand those things. And so me knowing these roads and sidewalks and trails and me knowing MARTA, and I know the education system. I went through K through 12 in Atlanta. I went through college in Atlanta. I went through my master's program in Atlanta. So from an educational perspective, I know Atlanta from soup to nuts, as they say, from A to Z. I also know the nonprofit sector. I was the chief development officer for a large nonprofit. And, I believe that me wanting to see this city be the best version of itself to deliver on the economic inclusion that Maynard Jackson talked about, and wanting to make sure that Black and brown people and women were able to lead businesses or get good jobs or et cetera. Now I'm the seventh Black mayor, and the seven is the number of completion. And so I want to make sure I carry out his vision by making sure we get to that economic inclusion, that equity that he espoused, that he talked about.
You also attended Georgia Tech. Can you speak to what that experience was like?
Yeah, I was the first in my family to go to college, the first to go to a university, and I went to Georgia Tech. So Tech was a special place for me and my family because it was a place that was different. First time I had ever studied with people that weren't Black. First time I was in a room that was that large before, 250 people sometimes in the classroom. Big things happened at Georgia Tech, and I was able to take my Atlanta Public Schools education, my mom and my family's upbringing, and took it to the big leagues by going to Tech. And then I joined the fraternity, Kappa Alpha Psi, that really solidified my brotherhood, and I had people I could depend on. That gave me a source of leadership where I became pole mark, and I learned how to, you know, deal with complex issues and competing interests. People want to do this, some want to do that. How do we find compromise? It helped me manage money. So tech was perfect for me. I was able to perform on a big stage, like at a big, you know, Division I school, one of the top schools in the nation. To be able to go there and maintain my scholarship and keep a 3.0 average, but still, I was the president of the African American Student Union. I was on Student Government Association. I helped with political campaigns, and I was able to be a part of a lot of significant things that have paved the way for others at Georgia Tech. All that demonstrated to me that anything is possible. So it gave me this confidence. It gave me a skill set that I take with me in business. It gives me a skill set that I take with me in politics. And it also, you know, it gave me a boldness of spirit that I can do just about anything, like run for mayor and win.
And now there's a big push for to get young people in STEM fields, especially to get Black youth in STEM fields. And I know that you, when you were at Georgia Tech, you majored in chemical engineering. So can you speak to how, what led you to choose that major in that field? And even if it blends into, even if that skill set blends into your job as mayor today?
Yeah, you know, I was good at chemistry and math. I was always good at math ever since I was second, third grade. And then I got, I was good at chemistry, took AP chemistry as well in high school. And so with that, my teacher, my counselor said, you ought to be a chemical engineer. Now, I didn't know what an engineer was, nor a chemical engineer at the time. I didn't know anybody that was an engineer. She made me look it up. I found out what it was, and you know, in the library at school. And I saw that they made great money. I saw that, you know, to get there, you had to know a lot about math and science and be interested in it. And I said, sure, that's what I'll do. I signed up for a summer program called MIT, Minorities Interested in Technology and Engineering, I think that's what it was. And I did that. And STEM was great for me because, you know, I have this, you know, analytical mind now, scientific method. I make decisions. I try to make rational decisions. I try to make fact-based decisions and data-driven decisions and think through problems and think about variables, your knowns, your unknowns, the pathway that's been followed before is probably the pathway we can follow now. And any deviations you take, you got to take a calculated risk. And so engineering has helped me be a better leader because I think through problems differently, systematically. I'm emotional about a few things, but I'm scientific about most things. And so I can compartmentalize and make sure we just do the job and, you know, serve people and help move society forward. With the fire in my belly and with the scientific knowledge that I have, STEM serves me well as a leader of a city because I can just solve problems in a much faster, more succinct and robust way.
As you mentioned before, you became a member of Kappa Alpha Psi while at Georgia Tech. Can you speak as to what drew you to that fraternity in the first place and the role that it continues to play in your life today?
Yeah, Kappas are just cool. I mean, that was the first thing about it. The noobs were the guys that were getting their schoolwork done, but they also were leading in the organizations, the planning of events, the parties, the social functions. They were the counselors for the incoming freshmen. So they were cool. They were, you know, they knew how to have fun, but they also managed their business. Kappa Alpha Psi is all about achievement in every field of human endeavor. And I said, okay, I can get with that. That's me. That's what I want to be about. You know, because at the time when I got to Georgia Tech, I would introduce myself as, hi, I'm Andre Dickens. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. I'm a chemical engineering major, and I want to be mayor of Atlanta. That's my introduction. They would, you know, they say, stand up and introduce yourself. And I would say, hi, my name is Andre Dickens. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia. I'm a chemical engineering major, and I want to be mayor of Atlanta. And I was saying that, and people were like, well, okay. I said, hey, that's what it is. I know my goal, I know my dream. And Kappa helped me with my goals and my dreams along the way. And here I am. Without Kappa, I don't know if I'd be here.
And do you have any words of encouragement for Kappa Leaguers who are in support of your run as mayor?
Well, my words of encouragement are thank you first, but the words of encouragement to Kappa Leaguers and their parents are stay the course. Continue to fight for what you believe in. You know, keep the main thing. The main thing, as I like to say, if you want to be an engineer, if you want to be an actor, if you want to be a movie star, a music producer, if you want to be a developer builder, if you want to build out apps, keep the main thing and focus on that. And I encourage you to really work harder than anybody else that is competing for that same type of outcome. But for Kappa Leaguers that are trying to pursue a heavy, big lift, a big goal, you know, go for it. Believe in yourself, ask others for help, and don't ever let anybody tell you that you can't do it because, you know, I think that you've seen enough people in our society that have accomplished incredible things. Ordinary people doing extraordinary tasks are all around us. And I say, stay encouraged and keep the faith and keep going.
Thank you so much for your time, Mayor Dickens.
All right. Thank you so much for your time. And continue to be a bright, awesome young man and encourage others to be the same. And I'll be here for you.
Thank you.
Great interview, Niles. Kappa Leaguers across the country perform service projects in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Decatur Alumni Kappa League in Georgia and Mobile Kappa League in Alabama were committed to making a difference.
I'm Hunter Goins with Decatur Kappa League, and you're watching Kappa League TV. The King holiday is celebrated as a day on, not a day off. Recently, Decatur Kappa Leaguers used their time off to serve others. Decatur Kappa Leaguers and their mentors visited the Chapel Hill Lenta Pantry in East Point, Georgia.
We have been here for about 5 years, and I have been the coordinator for about 3. We have taken the initiative to connect with Hands on Atlanta in order to allow us to connect with other organizations, such as the Decatur Alumni Kappa League.
Working with the mobile pantry, they sorted fruits and vegetables provided by local produce companies.
So we reach out to everyone and try to give them, you know, as much food as we can until supplies are gone.
After sorting the items in bags, the Kappa Leaguers met with the families and loaded them in cars as they arrived. The Kappa Leaguers were happy to help, and the organizers were appreciative of their service.
We're grateful anytime that organizations or individuals come to volunteer. So we want to say thank you for this opportunity to connect with the Decatur Alumni Kappa League, and we pray that this is going to be a lasting relationship.
Reporting for Kappa League TV, I'm Hunter Goins.
Hello, my name is Jarius Waters, and we are here at Feeding the Gulf Coast, dropping out canned goods for MLK Day.
Hi, my name is Taylor Carey, and I'm with the Mobile Kappa League, and today we're out here with Mobile Baykeeper trying to pick up some trash and help the community for the Martin Luther King Day of Service. Dr. King is a very important figure who invoked change, not only locally, but nationally, and today we're hoping to invoke change by picking up trash and keeping the city clean.
My name is Bryson Devine, the president of the Elite Chapter of the Mobile Kappa League, and today we stopped by the Ronald McDonald House on our MLK Day of Service to help out our families in need. The Mobile Kappa League is always willing to help and serve our community, and we're always a cut above.
Black History Month is a great time to reflect on the contributions and accomplishments of African Americans throughout time. Kappa Leaguers from New Brunswick alumni in New Jersey now highlight Black History heroes.
Hi, I'm Gerald Daniels. I'm on behalf of New Brunswick Kappa League. Today I'm talking about LaShawn Thomas for Black History Month. LaShawn Thomas worked on the famous anime called Yusuke, which is about the first black samurai. This has inspired a lot of African Americans because not many African Americans are able to work on this kind of stuff in Tokyo. So this is really inspiring for people, including me, and is why I want to become a manga artist.
Today, for Black History Month, I'm going to be talking about the entertaining life of Bernard Jeffrey McCullough, also known as Bernie Mac. Bernie Mac was an entertainer who was born in Chicago and who unfortunately died of pneumonia in 2008. He is most widely known for his sitcom that aired in the early 2000s called The Bernie Mac Show, where he taught young black men how to be fathers to young black children.
For Black History Month, I'll be talking about the Tuskegee Airmen. They were nicknamed as the Red Tails because their signature was to paint the propellers and the tails red. They fought in World War II. They formed the 332nd Expeditionary Group and the 447th Bombardment Group in the U.S. Air Force. They consisted of multiple black African-American people, and they inspired all other black people because they showed everybody that if they had a dream, they could go pursue it. A way that they did that is fighting through the Jim Crow laws, and that basically said how black people couldn't be pilots. And they fought through that adversity from anywhere else. They were trained at Tuskegee, Alabama, and the Tuskegee Institute.
For Black History Month, I want to focus on the life and legacy of Jesse Owens. He won 3 gold medals at the 1936 World Olympics, and he is regarded as one of the most known track and field athletes of all time. He is also one of the first world champions to be sponsored by Adidas.
Paul Robeson was born on April 9, 1898. He graduated from Rutgers, New Brunswick. He was a 2-time All-American and also his class valedictorian. After college, he was a music performer, traveling the country, and a big part and big impact of the Renaissance. He was a part of 2 musicals that would later become movies, which he played and acted in. He was also in Ortho, a Shakespeare play that was the longest running and still active longest running show on Broadway.
Today for Black History Month, I am doing Sidney Poitier, and became the first black actor to be nominated for the Academy Award in 1963 for the film Lilies of the Field. He was described as the sole representative of African Americans in mainstream cinema during the 1950s and 60s. Despite his roles in changing African perceptions of race and opening doors to a new generation of black actors, Mr. Poitier remained modest about his career. In 1967, Mr. Poitier appeared in 3 of Hollywood's top grossing films. They were In the Heat of the Night, To Sir with Love, and Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. In 2009, he was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Mr. Poitier will be greatly missed, but he will never be forgotten.
Kappa brother Chuck Kennebrew was one of 5 college football players to integrate the team at the University of Georgia in the early 70s. Donovan Lowry of Atlanta Smyrna's Junior Kappa League has the story.
Thank you for your time, Mr. Kennebrew.
Sure, Donovan. Anytime I have an opportunity to be interviewed by a Kappa League, I feel it's special, and I'm honored.
How did you end up at the University of Georgia, and what was the social climate like back then for African American athletes at the school?
I ended up at the University of Georgia primarily because that's the school that my parents wanted me to go to. I was highly recruited by other schools in the SEC and some in the ACC, but my desire was to go to the University of Tennessee. And the reason why was because they already had 3 or 4 African Americans football players who were starters, and I didn't want to go through a scenario where I was the first to integrate again. And so when the night before I was making a final decision, my dad reminded me that when I was 6 years old, he had interviewed me with my sister's tape recorder where I was the first black athlete at the University of Georgia. He reminded me of that, and that played very heavily on my mind, and I knew that my parents really wanted me to go to to school and state. Plus, my dad loved UGA. So, you got to remember that we were the first, and the team was 100% white before we got there. A lot of the players had never played with African-American players, and so we were new to them. Fortunate for the five of us, all of us had gone through integration and we were accustomed to being around white athletes, but there were some issues initially, but we worked through that.
You and four other teammates broke the color line on the field. What was it like off the field, and were you aware that you were creating a Black History moment?
We knew we were the first five. We knew that a lot of eyes would be on us. I don't think we thought about it being a Black History moment. Today, when I look back on it, I'm extremely proud of what we did, and it means a lot more to me now than it did during that period of time, because 50 years later, and university is still lifting up what we did. And when I look at the football team and I look at the whole athletic department, I think we had a profound impact on what you see today.
Were you successful on the field, and what was your athletic career like following UGA?
So there's two questions. The first question, was I successful on the field? And I would tend to say yes. My sophomore and junior year, I played a lot, but I was reserved. And then my senior year, I actually started. I was honorable mention, All-SEC. As far as the team is concerned, I was the meanest mother in the trench. That was the most valuable defensive lineman award. And so, yeah, from my standpoint, I definitely think that I had a high degree of success on the field. Afterwards, interestingly enough, I knew I wasn't good enough to play pro football. I think at some point in time, you have to be honest with yourself. It wasn't a pipe dream that I had. I had prepared for life after football. I graduated. My plans were to become a coach. And so I was a graduate assistant until I had an alumni who asked me to go out to a DuPont facility and interview for a job that I really wasn't interested in. And I went out and I interviewed for the job. They asked me to come back the following Monday. I came back the following Monday and interviewed with, you know, three more of their executives. And that Tuesday they offered me a job. So one thing that I learned about that experience is that you need to be prepared to pivot, because you never can tell when you're going to have an opportunity to do something else. When I look back at my business career, I feel very comfortable that, you know, there was a lot that I had accomplished, very successful. I retired from Floor & Decor in July of last year, and I retired as the Vice President for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. And prior to that, I had responsibility for the indirect procurement team, and so I was head of indirect purchases, which is a very pivotal role in a business that's going through growth.
How do you feel about your Bulldogs recently winning the national championship for the first time in 40 years?
I firmly believe that you have to have goals that are realistic. We got a new coach, and he came in 4 or 5 years ago, and I think he created the foundation for success. And so Alabama had been a thorn in our side, and I think we had gotten to a point where we had played catch up, and we were good enough to play on the same field and beat them. And so I was extremely happy. I was there. It was a moment of history, and I was extremely proud of the organization. And the most important thing is that when you look down on the field, you see a team that's 90% African Americans versus a team where you only have 5% of the team is African American. So I think we paved the way, and through the years, I think the athletic department recognized the importance of what we did, and I think you saw the results of it when we won the national championship. Everybody wants to be number one.
Based on your experience, what advice do you have for young people to be successful in reaching their goals?
Well, you know, I think that you have to establish a solid foundation. And one of the things that's important in my mind in establishing a foundation is making sure you get the right education. And so I don't care what profession that you want to go in, just make sure you establish a solid foundation so that you can build on it and just stay focused and be relentless. You know, do what's necessary to grow personally and professionally. You know, make sure you have a mentor. Make sure you have a sponsor who can make things happen. Make sure you learn how to network so that you can build and sustain relationships with people who could be influential to help you out.
Thank you again for your time, Mr. Kennebrew.
Now listen, thank you for taking the time to interview me. When I was your age, I'm not quite sure if I would be able to do what you're doing right now. And so I look up to you young men. And I wish you nothing but success. And I think the Kappa League is designed to help prepare you for the future. It's designed to expose you to things that under normal circumstances you might not get a chance to be exposed to. So I wish you nothing but success. And if there's anything that I can do to help you out, now that we know each other, feel free to knock on my door. You know, maybe in the fall you can come and go to a UGA game with me and see what that experience is all about.
Reporting for Kappa League TV, I'm Donovan Lowry.
Kappa League TV, where Kappa Leaguers and their mentors share their powerful stories, can be found at Kappa League TV on YouTube. This is Niles Holt with Alpharetta Smyrna Alumni Chapter Kappa League, and you're watching Kappa League TV.